My name is Samer Shahata, and I teach Middle East politics in the Department of International and Area Studies in the College of International Studies here at OU. And on behalf of the College of International Studies and the College's Iranian Studies program, I'd like to welcome you to tonight's lecture entitled Iran and the United States, Permanent Enemies or Natural Partners by Stephen Kinzer. We are very fortunate to have Mr. Kinzer with us this evening. But before I introduce him, I'd like to say a few words about how this event this evening is made possible. In 2010, through a generous donation by Mohammed and Jalal Farzaneh, who are here with us, the University of Oklahoma was able to create an Iranian studies program, including an endowed faculty position in Iranian studies with focus on culture and history of modern Iran. In the last 4 years, the program has become one of the most active Iranian studies programs in the U.S., hosting numerous lectures, conferences, events intended to take up questions about Iranian history and politics. Now, let me say a few words about Stephen Kinzer and why we are so fortunate to have him with us this evening. Mr. Kinzer is an award-winning foreign correspondent whose articles and books led the Washington Post to place him, quote, among the best in popular foreign policy storytelling, unquote. Mr. Kinzer spent more than 20 years working for the New York Times, most of it as a foreign correspondent. He was the Times bureau chief in Nicaragua during the 1980s and in Germany during the early 1990s. In 1996, he was named chief of the newly opened Times bureau in Istanbul. Later, he was appointed a national culture correspondent based in Chicago. Since leaving the Times, Mr. Kinzer has taught journalism, political science, and international relations at Northwestern University and Boston University. He has written books, numerous books, he's a prolific author, about Central America, Rwanda, Turkey, and Iran, as well as others that trace the history of American foreign policy. He contributes to the New York Review of Books and writes a world affairs column for The Guardian. He is presently a journalist in residence at Brown University's Watson Institute for International Studies. I've only managed so far to read one of Mr. Kinzer's books, which is outside, and I highly recommend it, All the Shah's Men, An American Coup and the Roots of Middle East Terror, and I look forward to reading Overthrow, and of course his most recent book, The Brothers John Foster Dulles, Alan Dulles, and Their Secret World War. Please join me in welcoming Stephen Kinzer.
Thanks so much for that. So you can hear everything I say. I guess I didn't need the microphone for that. Well, it's really wonderful to be out here and to see how much interest there is in Iran here in Oklahoma. This is a subject that I think will become more and more interesting and important for Americans in the coming years. And for that reason, I think it's important for us to try to break through the wall of misconception that really shapes so much of the perceptions that we have in this country about Iran. I grew up, like probably most of you, pretty ignorant about Iran and just vague ideas about the Middle East. And I've been so fortunate to have these years of involvement with Iran. I've really have been tremendously enriched by it. And I can honestly say I really started working on Iran without even knowing how great the food was. I have been invited into so many homes and had such fantastic meals. I wish I had started covering Iran a lot earlier in life. But I'm making up for it now. So as you heard earlier, I used to be the New York Times bureau chief in Istanbul, which was a fantastic job. And my beat was to cover Turkey, the Caucasus, and Central Asia. So I was not covering the Middle East, and I was not covering Iran. Let me move this. I want to have the Iran one sort of on my side. But one day I received a very fortuitous phone call. You know, New York Times correspondents have to be prepared to go anywhere and cover anything, which could make you a little suspicious of how deep our knowledge is. But I got a phone call saying, there's about to be an election in Iran, And the person who normally goes to cover this for us can't go. I forget if she was ill or couldn't get a visa or some problem. So you got to go to Iran. Well, having spent all of my time at that post learning about Turkey and the Caucasus and Central Asia, I really wasn't prepared for that assignment. But I'd gone on plenty of other assignments for which I was not prepared. So I happily leaped into that assignment. And after spending about a day banging on doors in the Iranian consulate in Istanbul, I did get my visa, and I arrived in Iran. This was the election in 1997 in which the reformist leader Mohammad Khatami was elected as president. So, as I said to you, I was not only not an Iran expert, but I really wasn't a Middle East expert. Turkey, of course, does not consider itself part of the Middle East, even though a lot of us might look at the map and think otherwise. So one thing I did know about the Middle East is that many of the countries in the Middle East are made-up countries. They're just invented by British or French diplomats drawing lines on maps, and they don't have a deep tradition. The cities are very old, of course, like Baghdad and Damascus. They go back millennia. But there's no such thing as Jordanian tradition or Iraqi heritage. These are very modern constructs. Well, it didn't take me very long in Iran to realize that this is the opposite of a fake country. This is not a made-up country. So Iran has existed more or less within the same boundaries, more or less with the same language, more or less with the same population mix for thousands of years. It has a tremendously rich culture. It's the first empire. The Persian Empire was the first empire in human history. King Cyrus is still revered as a great titan of history, author of the world's first human rights declaration, which is enshrined in the US Capitol, and a great conqueror, but also a very wise leader. Iran has gone through huge amounts of political upheaval, and Iranians have learned great lessons from existing over such a long period of time. It really is a great contrast to the United States. We've existed as a country about one-tenth as long as Iran has, and Iran has learned a lot of things by being around so long in history. One of the important lessons that Iran has learned, which I don't think the United States has had time to learn yet, is that no countries rule forever. Countries can be powerful and hugely influential for centuries. Then they start to decline. And they have low points. And they can get very low. And then they come up again. And they might go down again. That is a cycle of history. Americans are not quite prepared for this. And I think that's part of the reason for the psychological shock we're in now, because the very short arc of our history is somewhat misleading. It teaches us that a country can always get richer and stronger and more powerful, and that will go on forever. We're slowly sensing that maybe that's not going to be the case with us, and we really don't know how to deal with that. That's a good lesson we could learn from Iran. So in my first trip to Iran, I had a chance to travel all over the country. I got in a car with my photographer and an interpreter. We went everywhere. The country was quite open because it was a presidential election. There were a number of reporters. It's a huge country. And I got to sense some very important aspects of Iranian life. But here was the most important thing that occurred to me during that trip. Whenever I visit a foreign country, particularly if it's a country that I don't know very much about, I always ask myself this question: how did this country get like this? Why is this country rich and powerful? Why is this country poor and miserable? I'd like to try to understand the historical processes that created the country as it is now. One of the first things that I realized soon after arriving in Iran was that there was a huge disconnect, a huge contrast between what Iran should be based on its history and its culture and its size and its influence and what Iran is. Iran is isolated from the world. Iran is unhappy in terms of its political place in the world. Iran is a kind of a pariah in the eyes of many in the world. But yet, Iran has this enormous history and
all of this cultural riches. So why is that? What happened? Why is Iran not where it should be in the world? Well, I started asking this very quickly to some of the Iranians that I met. What happened to you? Why were you never able to develop into a modern democracy? And I got a few eye rolls, and some people gently took me aside and said, oh, you know, we did have a democracy here until you showed up and took it away from us. So I was a little bit taken aback by that. Didn't really fit in with my self-image as an American. And I resolved that when I got home, the first thing I was going to do was buy a book and find out what they were talking about. People told me, just go back and look at what happened in 1953 and you'll understand. So I had a vague understanding that there was some political upheaval in 1953. And when I got home, I decided, I looked for this book. So find me a couple of books about what happened in 1953 in Iran. Imagine my surprise to discover that there was no book on this subject. And I realized after searching for it that if I ever wanted to read that book, I was going to have to write it myself. And so that's when I set out to write this book, All the Shah's Men, which is exactly on this subject of the coup of 1953. And I'll tell you very briefly what I discovered. I don't want to give you all the details. You won't have any reason to buy the book. Iran has been on the road towards democracy for over 100 years. Iran has had a constitution for more than 100 years. There are other countries in the Middle East that don't have constitutions even today. Iranians had to fight for their democracy against an autocratic royal regime in the period of 1906 to 1909. During that period, a young American school teacher named Howard Baskerville was carried away. He was actually from Nebraska. He got carried away with the revolutionary struggle for democracy in Iran, and he led a little group of fighters, and he was killed fighting for Iranian democracy. That makes him the only American to have died for the cause of Iranian freedom. And I think with his blood, he really did seal some kind of a bond between our two peoples. Actually, I'm going to be leading a tour to Iran in May, and I made it a condition of accepting this job. I want to go to a city in Iran I've never been to before. That's Tabriz up in the north. And when the organizer asked me, why do you want to go there? I explained that, of course, the cuisine is very good, and I want to know about that part of the country. But the real reason is I want to go to Howard Baskerville's grave. I want to go to the grave of the only American who gave his life for Iranian freedom and pay my respects. During the early part of the 20th century, Iran was on the brink of disappearing as a nation. A formidable modernizing dictator named Reza Shah came to power and essentially rescued Iran, a very harsh and cruel leader, but also a visionary modernizer. During the Second World War, he was deposed by the British, and the British promoted his young son to the throne, but the throne was very weak during that period. And this was the time when the democracy that had been promised in the early years of the century really began to flower. So in the late 1940s and early 1950s, Iran made tremendous strides towards realizing its democracy. There were elections. Parliament was very active in debating the issues of national import. And it was during this period that the remarkable figure of Mohammad Mossadegh emerged. Mossadegh became Prime Minister of Iran in 1951. He was a very theatrical, dramatic figure. And he became famous as a member of Parliament for his advocacy of one cause. Iran, as you may know, is sitting on top of an ocean of oil. Starting in the beginning of the 20th century, this oil has been the property exclusively of one company in Great Britain. And this company is owned mainly by the British government. So what it meant was that the British had a full monopoly on all drilling, refining, exporting and selling of Iranian oil. No Iranian had any right to Iranian oil. The entire standard of living in Britain, all during the 1920s and 30s and 40s, was based 100% on Iranian oil. Every factory in Britain was running on oil from Iran. Britain has no oil, has no other colony with oil. The Royal Navy, which projected British power all over the world, was fueled 100% by oil from Iran. Meanwhile, the people in Iran were living in some of the most miserable conditions of anybody in the world. It was Mossadegh who came up with this idea that this was the great injustice of Iranian life. On the day that he was elected by Parliament as Prime Minister, in his typically dramatic fashion, he responded to his nomination by pulling out a piece of paper out of his jacket pocket. This must be a great scene in some future movie, and saying, "Thank you for nominating me as Prime Minister, but before I accept, I want to read you this one proposal I have." It was a proposal to nationalize Iranian oil and make it the property of the Iranian people. He said, "I want the Parliament to vote first in favor of the idea of nationalizing our oil. If you vote for this, then make me Prime Minister and I will accomplish it." That bill was passed unanimously by the Iranian Parliament. Mossadegh became Prime Minister, and with the full support of the Iranian people, he fulfilled the great mission of that country in the 20th century, which was to take back control of their one great natural resource. Now, needless to say, the British were not so pleased with this. The British tried everything they could to get rid of Mossadegh. They tried to bribe him. They tried what we now call sanctions. They blockaded the flow of goods into Iran. They required all the British technicians who were working in the giant refinery to go home, even though many of them wanted to stay and Mossadegh wanted to keep them. They imposed a military naval blockade around the refinery port in case the Iranians could find any way to refine the oil under the unequal treaty that the previous Iranian monarchy had signed with the British. The British promised that they would train Iranian technicians to run that refinery, but of course they never did. So the refinery basically ground to a halt, and the British came to Mossadegh and said, "Look, if you don't make a deal with us, nobody will get the oil. It'll just sit under the ground and nobody will get any money." And Mossadegh's answer, he spoke French, was, "Tant pis pour nous, too bad for us. Let's just leave it in the ground then. No problem." The British tried to organize a what they called a quasi-legal coup against Mossadegh. In any parliamentary democracy, of course, the parliament can have a no-confidence vote in the prime minister at any time, and the prime minister must resign. So the British started bribing members of parliament to vote no confidence in Mossadegh. But Tehran is actually quite a small town, and not surprisingly, Mossadegh got wind of this. He found out what the British were doing, and he did the only thing that he could do to protect himself. He closed the British embassy, and he expelled all the British diplomats. Among those diplomats were all the agents and spies that were doing the bribing of the parliament. So now the British were out of cards. They had nothing. They had no way to get rid of Mossadegh, and they had lost this great national asset. So what did they do? They decided to ask their friends in Washington for help. The British sent one of their principal intelligence officers. Actually, the guy that had been the head of the British intelligence MI6 spy service in Tehran before Mossadegh closed the embassy, to Washington to make this deal. His mission was convince the Americans to overthrow Mossadegh for us. This guy, Christopher Montagu Woodhouse, has written a memoir. He has had a very colorful life. He did many other things. This was actually just a small part of his career. But there's a page or two in his memoir about this mission. And those couple of paragraphs really turned to red on the page to me when I read them. What he wrote essentially was this: "I was flying across the Atlantic and trying to think through my presentation. How was I going to make this appeal to the Americans? And I realized that the argument we were supposed to use probably wasn't going to work. That argument was, this madman took away our oil company,
please overthrow him so we can have our oil company back. I realized that wasn't going to mobilize the Americans. I had to find another argument. And knowing as I did what Americans were thinking in the early 1950s, I came up with a new idea. I decided I'm not even going to mention oil. I'm going to come up with a completely different argument. My appeal is going to be, you guys should overthrow Mossadegh because Mossadegh will lead Iran toward communism. Now, Mossadegh was an elderly, feudal landlord who despised all Marxist and socialist ideas. But we didn't know very much about that. In fact, as I was writing this book, All the Shah's Men, I read all the declassified documents. You can trace the development of the coup against Mossadegh almost day by day as it goes through the American policy process. And there's only one time that I found when one American official in a meeting of the National Security Council questions the idea that we should be overthrowing Mossadegh to stop communism. And it was none other than President Eisenhower himself. Essentially what he said, I'm paraphrasing now, was, I'm glad we're overthrowing Mossadegh to stop communism, but I didn't realize that Mossadegh was a communist. And the Secretary of State, John Foster Dulles, had a great answer. He said, oh, you're right, he's not a communist, but Mossadegh is old. Mossadegh is sick. He could die. He could be overthrown. There could be upheaval. There is a communist party in Iran. Iran is on the border with the Soviet Union. They have a lot of oil. There could be instability. Ultimately, that could lead to a communist takeover. And Eisenhower essentially was satisfied. He said, okay, I get it. Let's overthrow him. So in the middle of the summer of 1953, the head of the CIA Middle East Division, an officer named Kermit Roosevelt, arrived in Iran with the job of overthrowing Mossadegh. Kermit Roosevelt was none other than the grandson of Theodore Roosevelt, who had been responsible for America's takeover of Cuba and Puerto Rico and the Philippines and other places. So I'm thinking maybe the regime change gene might be running in that Roosevelt family. So Kermit Roosevelt got to Iran and set to work on his project. That was actually one of the most interesting parts of the story for me. I asked myself, so how do you overthrow a government? Suppose you get sent to another country and your job is overthrow the government. So what do you do on the first day? You get to your office Monday morning. How do you start? And then what do you do on the second day? Well, I now know. And I've often thought if this professor thing doesn't work out, I've got another career. Because the regime change thing seems to be very hot these days. Anyway, I don't want to give it all away, but to put it very briefly, within a couple of weeks, Kermit Roosevelt had bribed more than half the newspapers in Tehran, which started publishing terrible things about Mossadegh. Mossadegh was a Jew, a British agent, a homosexual, everything that they could come up with. The CIA was feeding them all these stories. Kermit Roosevelt also bribed mullahs to denounce Mossadegh from the pulpits in the mosques. He bribed military officers and police units. He even hired one of the most famous gangsters in Tehran, a guy who was wonderfully named Shaban the Brainless, to bring out his gang of thugs. And he told them, what I want you to do is rampage through the streets, break the shop windows, fire your guns into the mosques, beat people up, and yell, we love Mossadegh and communism. That was pretty clever. I might have thought of that one, but Kermit Roosevelt was even smarter than I would have been. He came up with an even better idea than that. After he sent Shaban the Brainless and his mob through Tehran, he hired another mob to attack Shaban's mob. So you had days of bitter street fighting in Tehran, and Kermit Roosevelt's idea, which actually I think was very clever, was to try to convey to the ordinary citizens of Tehran that Mossadegh had completely lost control of the country. And it worked. And also Mossadegh, having lived in Switzerland and being so profoundly democratic, didn't want to send police out to crush these rebels. His idea was,
people have a right to express themselves, and the right thing will come out of this. I don't think he ever realized that the CIA was behind all this. And certainly the people rampaging on the streets had no idea who was paying their bosses. So at the end of August, after just 3 weeks in Tehran, Kermit Roosevelt succeeded in his plot of overthrowing the democratic government of Mohammad Mossadegh. That episode really was a great object lesson in how easy it is for a rich and powerful country to throw a poor and weak country into chaos. Mossadegh was not only overthrown personally, the entire democratic system in Iran came to an end. That was the end of democracy in Iran. You can imagine what a traumatic shock this was for Iranians at the time. It's something that they've never gotten over, because they've never managed to return to where they were in 1953. So as a result of our coup, we reinstalled Mohammad Reza Shah back on his peacock throne. He had cowered, he had bravely fled to Rome on the first day of trouble in Iran. So he came back. And for the next 25 years, Mohammad Reza Shah ruled Iran with increasing repression. His repression produced the explosion of the late 1970s, what we call the Islamic Revolution. That resulted in the Shah's overthrow and the emergence in power of this militantly anti-American religious regime, the successor to of which we are now living with at this moment in Iran. Now, that revolution of 1979 was a delayed reaction to our overthrow of Iranian democracy in 1953. And that revolution in Iran had profound results, not just inside Iran, but far beyond. Just to mention a couple of them. First of all, this upheaval in Iran led Iran's greatest enemy next door, Saddam Hussein in Iraq, to decide Iran is now weak. Iran is in upheaval. Now's the time to attack them. And sure enough, Saddam attacked Iran during this period. That was in 1982. That was the beginning of a long and brutal war that lasted for 8 years, resulted in hundreds of thousands of deaths. And that war had a great impact on the United States. We were so unhappy with Iran that we sided with Saddam Hussein in that war. We provided intelligence and helicopters and other support for Saddam, and that was the beginning of our death embrace with Saddam that spiraled down into all our subsequent trouble in Iraq. The revolution of 1979 in Iran was one of those rare episodes that led not only the United States, but also the Soviet Union to panic. The Americans realized that they had lost everything in Iran. They had a leader there, the Shah, who would do everything we wanted, and then they wound up with a regime that hated us. So it was we saw that as a huge strategic loss, and we were right, it was. But what we didn't realize is the Soviets felt the same way. They were terrified at this revolution. Why? Because the idea of radical fundamentalist Islam rising up and overthrowing secular regimes is very frightening to them, since all of their southern republics were Muslim. They were terrified at the example this might set. And it was their terror at this possibility that led them to launch their invasion of Afghanistan. That was what drew us into Afghanistan. That was the precursor to all the trouble we have had since then in Afghanistan. Now, the 1979 revolution in Iran was also the precursor to an episode with which we are all familiar, the hostage crisis. That was a time when a group of several hundred Iranian students, just almost exactly 35 years ago this week, stormed into the American embassy and took a group of hostages. They held 54 of those hostages for well over a year. And this episode had a hugely traumatic impact in the United States. It was deeply humiliating for us. We were watching on television every night as those blindfolded hostages were walking around being taunted by Iranians who held up this sign that really, I think, deeply wounded Americans because it was so true. And the sign said, America cannot do anything. Americans are not used to situations that we can't control, and this was one we couldn't control. That crisis left a deep scar on the American psyche. Now, when Americans look at the U.S.-Iran relationship, essentially we date it all from the hostage crisis. For us, U.S.-Iran relations begin and end with the hostage crisis. That's the huge episode. Everything else is just background noise. But for Iranians, the world looks very different. To them, the hostage crisis was an unfortunate incident at a time when there were a lot of unfortunate incidents. They were about to go into a war that shattered their whole country. That was a trauma far greater than the hostage crisis. To them, the real decisive moment in U.S.-Iran relations was the 1953 coup, the crushing of Iranian democracy. So we have parallel narratives that never really coincide. We understand history in completely different ways. And I think that's one of the difficulties that have impeded reconciliation between these two countries. Now, there have been a number of efforts to try to bridge this gap over the years. There have been times when Iran seemed ready to extend a hand of friendship, but we weren't ready. There were times when we started to try to extend a hand of friendship. Iran was not ready. There have been some moments when it really looked like this might happen. Perhaps the most promising one was at the time right after the 9/11 bombings. You might know that in the entire Muslim world, there was only one place where large numbers of people spontaneously went out onto the streets with candles to mourn the tragedies of 9/11, and that was in Tehran. Iran was the only country in the world, in the Muslim world, where people came out in great numbers in sympathy with the United States. And the Americans were then desperate to do whatever we could to overthrow the Taliban regime that had been the nest from which this terrorist attack emerged. We didn't really know anything about Afghanistan, but the Iranians knew all about Afghanistan. Don't forget the entire western third of Afghanistan used to be part of Iran until they lost a war in the 18th century, and the language is the same. Iran has very, very deep contacts and very detailed knowledge of Afghanistan. Also, Iran is the militant enemy of radical Sunni jihadist movements like Taliban and Al-Qaeda. While the United States was still trying to embrace the Taliban, when we still wanted to do business with the Taliban, the Iranians were warning us, don't get together with these guys. They hate us and they hate you. Finally, we realized they were right. So now, finally, after 9/11, the Americans were ready to fight the Taliban, and the Iranians came to us and said, okay, we're with you. We're going to help you. We didn't know how we could overthrow the Taliban. It was the Iranians who told us, you should get in touch with the Northern Alliance, this group of non-Pashtun tribes in the north of Afghanistan. They hate the Taliban too, and they will be your ground fighters. The Americans, as you remember, never sent large amounts of ground troops into Afghanistan. We did the bombing, but we needed a ground force. It was the Iranians who connected us with the Northern Alliance. After the war was over and the Taliban was overthrown, we had to figure out what would be a new government for Afghanistan. We had something called the Bonn Conference in Germany, in which various Afghan factions came. Of course, the Northern Alliance, having done all the work on the ground, decided that they should name the new president of Afghanistan. But the Americans didn't want that because we wanted a president who was Pashtun, who represented the largest ethnic group, even though that was the group from which the Taliban sprung. It was the Iranians who went to the Northern Alliance and convinced them, you have to stand down. You have to stand back and let the guy the Americans want, Karzai, come in as president. So it was through their help that we not only overthrew the Taliban, but established the Karzai regime. The Iranians really believed this was the moment now when they were going to start reconciliation with the United States. Immediately after that is when President George W. Bush made his famous speech placing Iran in the axis of evil. He took two of the world's worst terror dictatorships, North Korea and Iraq, and then he threw Iran in with them. This was a huge shock to the Iranians. Later, many years later, I read this interview. I still can't get it out of my mind with the speechwriter who wrote that speech. And they asked him, how did you ever think to put Iran in the category with those two other countries like North Korea and Iraq? And he said, well, it wasn't in the first draft, but somebody read it and said, if it's an axis, you can't have just two, you need three. So we had to put it in another country. We thought, well, how about Iran? Oh, let's put them in too. So that's the way Iran became part of the axis of evil. There are a series of other terrible misunderstandings like that. But finally, within the last year or so, we seem to be finally on a page where we're reading the same words and thinking the same things. The nuclear negotiations going on in Oman, and finally they're going to be finishing in Vienna soon, are highly promising. Whether we will reach an agreement by this week, which is our next deadline, is highly uncertain. There's a lot of brinksmanship going on in the last minute in all these kinds of negotiations. I do think the senior leadership in Iran has made a decision that this is a good thing, that lifting of the sanctions is something Iran needs, and surrendering the idea of nuclear weapons is not going to be a big sacrifice for Iranians. So I think the hardliners in Iran who are making a lot of money off the sanctions and are opposed to reconciliation are under control. I'm not sure the hardliners in Washington are under control. Maybe we need a supreme leader who can put them in line the way the supreme leader has apparently done in Iran. So militants on both sides are determined to try to upset this agreement. Nonetheless, I think we're at a very promising moment now. This is something of profound importance. It's not just the question of two countries that have been enemies that should stop being enemies. There's a huge strategic benefit for both sides, and particularly for the United States in these negotiations. And when I look at the world, I conclude that the only real durable basis for international relations is the pursuit of national self-interest. Countries always, in the end, pursue their own interests. You need to realize this fact, if you want to try to reach any kind of diplomatic agreement. What you have to do is find ways that national interests coincide. So I'm all in favor of the United States pursuing its own interest in the world. But my only caveat is this. Let's pursue our own interest, but let's be careful to think about what really is in our interest over the long run, and not do things that just make us feel good for a few days, but actually wind up undermining our security over the long run. This is a trap we have fallen into too often. If we can reach some kind of an accord with Iran that leads to not simply a reduction in the nuclear threat, but also some broader opening between our countries, we can produce great strategic benefits for ourselves. What would they be? Well, first of all, Iran looks at the world, as all countries do, to figure out what are its true existential threats. And I can tell you, at the top of the list is not America. Iran does not consider America to be a major threat, and they don't consider Israel to be a major threat. Actually, in Iranian strategic doctrine, they only see two what they call existential threats to the future of our nation. The first one is radical jihadist Sunni militancy, the Al-Qaeda, ISIS, Taliban nexus. Don't forget that Iran is, of course, the heartland of the Shia branch of Islam. And people of the ISIS, Al-Qaeda persuasion essentially want to kill every Shiite in the world. So that's a pretty good reason to be against them if you're a Shiite. These people are invaluable allies to us, the Iranians, in our fight against this militancy. And they have a huge advantage over us in their ability to fight those people. It's because they're from the neighborhood. They've lived there for thousands of years. We are outsiders. We're coming from thousands of miles away. We have a different religion. We don't know the neighborhood. Iranians are the best possible allies we can have in the fight against what we consider to be our greatest enemies in that part of the world. It is not sensible for us to try to wage this war that we seem to be going back into without partners on the ground. And Iran is the only real country in that part of the world that wants to be our partner. Our so-called friends, like Saudi Arabia, are actually the source of all the money that is going to Al-Qaeda and ISIS. So Iranian participation in our struggle against radical terrorism in the Middle East will make a decisive difference. Iran has a great ability to help stabilize Iraq. Don't forget that Iraq is the only country in the world outside Iran where there's a Shia majority. Shias have a deep connection to Iran, and Iran has an ability to stabilize Iraq that no other country has. Iran also has a great ability to help stabilize Afghanistan. But of course, they're only willing to participate in those projects if they can be sure that the Afghanistan that they help stabilize will then not be used as a base for people to attack Iran. Once we can work out some kind of an accord with Iran, Iran can be a great stabilizing factor in that part of the world. Iran also shares a number of other social and political interests with us. Just to take one, Iran has developed in recent years a terrible drug addiction problem. They are right next door to the country that produces most of the world's heroin, Afghanistan. That heroin, as it comes out from Afghanistan to the West, is all passing through Iran. In the old days, it just used to pass through, but now a lot of it is leaking out. Read your newspapers every day. Opiate addiction in this country is a serious problem. You can only control this problem at the source. You cannot control it at the consumer level. Iran and the United States are ideal partners in the anti-drug project in Afghanistan. That's a project that cannot be won simply by repression and burning fields. It's a deep, long-lasting agricultural development and social project. Iran understands that. So that's a kind of a project that Iran can participate in with us. And let me make one other observation. Iran is a model of stability when you compare it to the countries around it. Iran is near Syria. Iran is near Iraq. Iran is near Afghanistan. Look at what has happened to those countries. But it hasn't happened to Iran, and it's not going to. Now, when the Arab Spring uprisings were going on, and idealists were pouring out on the streets to overthrow their dictatorships, people asked me often, when is it going to happen in Iran? When is the revolution happening in Iran? And I tell them, oh no, forget that. Iran already had its revolution in 1979. Iran has a great lesson for the rest of the Middle East. And maybe I could put it in Shakespeare's phrase. It is sometimes better to bear those ills you know than fly to others that you know not of. Iranians across the political spectrum got together in 1979 to overthrow the Shah. Everybody, the communists, the Mossadegh liberals, the Islamists, people that hated each other and didn't agree on anything, came together to overthrow the Shah. Why? Because they all agreed on one obvious fact, which was, we don't know what's coming next, but it has to be better than this. Well, what happened? They got something worse. They have learned a profound lesson of history. And that is, try to work within the limited space that you have and make progress slowly. Iran is on the road to democracy. But Iranians have learned from their history to be patient. It's something Americans have not learned. Many of you remember the Green Movement protests that resulted from the apparently fraudulent election of 2009. They were brutally suppressed by the police, and I was in Iran shortly after that. And I remember meeting a family that was having a picnic. It was out at Cyrus's tomb, actually. And I was just chatting with people. I went to this family, and I asked this guy about the Green Movement. He had participated, And I said, oh, wasn't it awful? Wasn't it terrible? What are you going to do now? And he said, well, you know, we tried something. It didn't work. But now we just want to live our lives. Things are not so awful here that we want to throw ourselves on the bayonets of the Revolutionary Guard. He said, we're going to get the result we want. We're just not going to get it on the exact timetable that we expected. And that's a very Iranian way of looking at life and the world. Americans are very oriented towards solving problems. They want to get everything fixed. One thing I've learned from Iranians is a different attitude toward life, and that is, you know, a lot of problems in life are never going to be fixed. You just have to live your life and understand that you do the best you can under the circumstances that are around you. This is a great lesson for other peoples in the Middle East. And finally, I would add this. The human rights situation inside Iran today is truly deplorable. The problem is not only the lack of political freedom, but it's the lack of personal freedom. People are not allowed to live their own lives and dress the way they want and behave the way they want. Iran is evolving towards a more open society, but when a country is under intense pressure from the outside, it's natural for a government to fear any kind of change or popular movement. Once the pressure begins to ease, I believe Iranian society will begin to open up. Possibly it will open up enough so that many Iranian Americans will feel more comfortable either going back to live or going back to spend part of their time there. I don't think there's a diaspora in the world that has a higher level of talent than the Iranian diaspora. If you look in the computer industry and in medicine and so many other fields in the United States, you'll find Iranians up at the top there. So there is a huge untapped potential for Iran. Meanwhile, American corporations and European corporations are lusting to get into Iran. Iran is the last big unexploited consumer market in the world. You've got 70 million people living there. About 80% qualify as middle class. They're literate. The literacy rate under 25 is 100% in Iran. Meanwhile, 3/4 of the people in Iran are under the age of 35. They don't even remember the revolution. They're very Western oriented. I tell you, there is no place in the world where you will find more pro-American sentiment among ordinary people than Iran. This is something I think is always surprising to visitors who go there. It was surprising to me. The last time I was there, I was standing on a street corner in Shiraz, just waiting for the light to change. And some woman must have noticed that I didn't look Iranian, and she asked me where I was from. And as soon as I said, America, she said, her eyes popped open, and she practically started to shriek. And she was telling people, hey, this American guy right here. And within about 10 seconds, I had a dozen people around me, and they were smiling and waving. And one woman said to me, we know they say terrible things about us over there, but we love America so much. You don't even get that in Canada. There is a tremendous this is a country that is full of possibilities. And it's possibilities for business, for human cooperation, and for civil society. Iran, if allowed to develop freely, can become the kind of democratic society that can become a model for the countries around it. This is the way regions change. You don't bomb a country into democracy. You turn a country into democracy by having a model nearby that transfers its example. And there's no prospect that Syria or Iraq or most of the other countries in that region are going to be able to fulfill that role. Iran has the assets that we need to advance our own American security interests at the same time that we take steps that will help open up Iranian society and make Iran a better place for Iranians to live. Why is it so difficult for us to grasp this? I think a lot of it has to do with emotion. Emotion is always the enemy of wise statesmanship.
Americans are still caught up in the emotions left over from the hostage crisis. I can tell you, I was in Washington not very long ago, and I met a guy who is very immersed in the Washington establishment. He has been a journalist there for practically as long as I've been alive, which hasn't been quite as long as some of you might think. And I said to him, why is it that there is so much anti-Iran feeling in this town? And he immediately, without a minute hesitation, said, it all goes back to the hostage crisis. That's what opens the minds of American politicians to the anti-Iran propaganda that pours in from various sources. Now, it's true that these are two countries that have inflicted grievous harm on each other. We've both hurt each other a lot. You cannot escape from this history. But you shouldn't be imprisoned by history. I used to cover the Balkan Wars in Yugoslavia. One time I was taking a vacation, I came home and I had to go to my pharmacy on my corner in Boston and I had to buy a prescription. You know, sometimes those prescriptions come with little labels on it, like don't take after dark or don't take this if you're pregnant or something. This one said, it had a little sticker that really caught my attention. It said, not to be taken in excess of prescribed dosage. I like to put that on our history books. Be aware of our history. We can't deny that these are countries that have been hostile and that have caused each other harm. But we need to break out of that prison and realize that reconciliation with Iran is probably the single step that America could take in the world now that would most dramatically advance our security interests. Keep tuned. We might see a breakthrough in the coming days. We are at the moment of decision now. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Professor Kinzer has kindly agreed to take some questions, so I'd like to open the floor to questions, and we have a roving microphone here, so if you could raise your hand if you have a question, and the microphone will come to you.
Dr. Kinzer, you probably read the editorial written by Cal Thomas about November 4th that said, negotiating with Iran is like negotiating with the devil. And there was paragraph and paragraph and paragraph about nuclear weapons, and of course Iran is building a nuclear weapon and so on. And it seems as though certainly Cal Thomas and a faction of people in the United States, perhaps Mr. Netanyahu and much of the Israeli government, and certainly the shock jocks on Fox Radio, are proud to say that of course Iran is building a nuclear weapon. You know, you just can't believe what they say. Please talk about the inspections going on in Iran and the preconditions to the negotiations that are now going on in a way that might satisfy, or at least I'd like to have your opinion, if they do in fact demonstrate that Iran is not building a nuclear weapon, which is the great fear that I think blocks the rapprochement that you're talking about.
That's a very reasonable fear, and I share it myself. If you look at the history of the Iranian nuclear program over the last 20 years, you can see repeated instances where the Iranians have lied and cheated. They've actually taken a great page out of the Israeli book. That's how Israel built its nuclear program. They consistently denied that they were doing it, and when Americans sent inspectors to the Dimona plant, they actually had construction workers in there putting up false walls and pretending that their centrifuges did not exist. So the Iranians have done the same thing. I don't advocate any agreement that relies on trusting Iran to do anything, and that's not what this is about. There must be ironclad verification mechanisms built into any agreement. That is an absolute must. But this is the way to prevent Iran from having a nuclear weapon. You know, bombing them will not do it, because you can't bomb knowledge.
You can't bomb the knowledge of how to build a nuclear bomb out of people's heads. And assassinating nuclear scientists on the streets is not a way to do it. The way to do it is to have intrusive inspections and make sure we know everything Iran is doing. If we cannot include that as part of the deal, there won't be a deal. But look what our policy has produced up to now. When we started these sanctions, the number of centrifuges in Iran was under 1,000. Now it's over 10,000. So the sanction project has had the exact opposite effect that we had hoped it would have. And talking about this larger issue of Iran being the devil, it's really interesting to me to see the way people have come up with this concept. I actually don't think it has much to do with Iran itself. Iran is not really a place. It's not a physical spot with people and a history and a particular culture in the minds of many of these people. Iran, to them, is just the latest name that civilization has always given to the force of barbarism that wants to destroy civilization. It was just like the barbarian hordes that attacked Rome. We put this onto communism in the 1950s, or terrorism. Now it's called Iran. It's just that horrific force that wants to destroy civilization. And when I hear these members of Congress and columnists ranting like this, I have a little fantasy. And my fantasy is that when I'm in Washington and listening to one of these speeches, I get up and interrupt. And I interrupt this way. I hold up an outline map of the world. And I say, can you show me Iran on this map? Point it out. Where is it? I don't think they know where Iran is on a map. And many of these people, I don't even think, know where Israel is on a map. You don't need to know. So I'd like to see there be a rule in Congress that you cannot advocate the occupation, bombing, or attacking of any country that you can't find on a map.
Wonderful. Thank you. Before we take a second question, let me take the prerogative of the introducer or the MC to ask a question, also following up on this, to kind of push you a little bit harder. And I agree with much of what you've said, but how would you respond to the following? You said that states pursue their interests. Having nuclear capability is in Iran's interest. Bruce Rydell, who was national security advisor to President Clinton, has said if he was the national security advisor to the supreme leader, he would tell them, pursue nuclear capability. The lesson of Iraq, the lesson of North Korea, the lesson of Libya, vis-a-vis American foreign policy, is if you have nuclear weapons, North Korea, and so on, the United States is not going to pursue regime change against you, right? That's the first point. Second point is, if you look at Iran's regional interests and ambition and weight, Iran supports Hezbollah. Iran supports the Syrian regime. Iran, whether this is good or not, is opposed to the Sunni minority regime in Bahrain, is opposed to America's ally, Saudi Arabia. Thirdly, there is the question of Israel, whether however you view this U.S.-Israeli relationship, I think it's fair to say that the Israelis are quite terrified of the possibility of U.S.-Iranian rapprochement, right? And then fourthly, intentionally, because usually human rights, unfortunately, is not at the top of American priorities when it comes to foreign policy, there are real issues with regard to Iran's human rights record. And so how would you respond to that kind of more realist perspective about why Iran might be pursuing nuclear capability, about why Iran's regional ambitions really are quite different from what America wants to see in the region and so forth?
You should be a professor. Okay, you raised some very good points. First of all, about nuclear weapons capacity being in Iran's interest. I think you can argue the case that Bruce Rydell argued, that nuclear capacity could be helpful for Iran in some ways. But if you look at it in the larger sphere of everything that pursuing nuclear weapons will bring down onto Iran, I think they could make the calculation it isn't worth it. We are becoming more and more isolated as we are thought to be pursuing this project. Therefore, considering our overall interests, maybe it would be better to surrender this one in the hope that we can then pursue our other interests. And I repeat, if you want to prevent Iran from ever having a nuclear weapon, reaching an accord with Iran that includes ironclad guarantees of inspections is the best way to do it. As far as rapprochement with America being against our interests, against our regional interests, I think it's true that some of our traditional friends in that part of the world don't like this idea at all. We found out a great phrase in one of those WikiLeaks cables where the king of Saudi Arabia tells the American ambassador it's time to cut off the head of the snake. He was talking about Iran. Maybe it's time for us to ask ourselves who our real friends in the Middle East are. Saudi Arabia has been a good friend to American oil companies, and it's been a great consumer for our weapons industry. But Saudi Arabia is the source of the seed funding for all these radical Sunni movements against which we've been fighting for years. All those madrasas that were built in the 1990s and back into the 1980s, everywhere from Indonesia to Bosnia to Uzbekistan, were filled with Saudi preachers and built with Saudi money. I saw that happening when I was covering Central Asia. Those are the schools for the terrorists that have come out to kill Americans. Saudi millionaires and billionaires from other parts of the Gulf are the principal financiers of these organizations, which makes sense because they're promoting this rigid, austere form of Islam that is dominant in Saudi Arabia. The Saudi state is built on a deal between the Al Saud family and the Wahhabi clergy. The deal is this. The Al Saud family supports the Wahhabi establishment and allows it to maintain the kind of religious rule that it wants and encourages it and finances it to go out and promote radical fundamentalist uprisings throughout the Islamic world. In exchange, the clergy promises not to promote any upheaval in Saudi Arabia and not to criticize the strongly un-Islamic behavior of the 6,000 princes who rule Saudi Arabia and spend the oil money in the casinos of Marseille. So Saudi Arabia, in the long run, is pursuing policies that I would argue have undermined American interests. It's true that during the Iraq War, Iran was indirectly responsible for projects that wound up killing Americans in Iraq. That's a real truth. It's also true that the Americans have been killed throughout that region as a result of what Saudi Arabia has done. And you know, it's interesting. When I talk to American Middle East policymakers who are inside the consensus or the government, and I put this to them, how can you be arguing for supporting Saudi Arabia when Saudi Arabia is doing this and this and this? And they all say, well, you're right, that's what they do. But you have to understand the Saudi situation. You got to realize where they are, the complex domestic political pressures that are underway there, which is, I understand that, that's a good answer. But I want to know, why don't you say that about Iran too? Iran also is in a very complex geopolitical and domestic environment. And if you want to try to excuse bad behavior on one side, you should try to do it on the other side as well. As far as Israel goes, I'm going to tell a story about the last time I was in Israel. I was actually there for a conference about Iran. And if you want to get detained at the airport in Tel Aviv, just tell them when they ask you, what are you doing here? You say, you're coming to talk about Iran. You immediately get taken off into another room for interrogation. Fortunately, I had been given a phone number to call at Tel Aviv University where the conference was going on. They told me, you will be stopped at the airport. You will be detained. When you're detained, give the guy this phone number. Sure enough, after an hour, they let me go. So we had the conference. And then at the end of the conference, they took us off for a dinner, the panelists. So there were maybe 20 of us. And there were a few, and the hosts were there. We were in one of those nice hotels overlooking the Mediterranean. And then the host got up and said, well, we've got a special guest for you. And in walked a figure who's one of the most prominent leaders of the Israeli government. The first thing he said before he said a word was, there's no journalist here, right? And I was just about to raise my hand, and then I held it down. I said, well, you're not here as a journalist. You're just a panelist. But he did make sure to make us all pledge that we weren't going to say the guy's name. If I tell you his name, you'll know exactly who I mean. Anyway, this is a person who's been in the center of Israeli policymaking for years. And he said, I want to give you a tour d'horizon of how we are seeing the world, which wound up being about 80% about Iran. And here's what he said. He said, you're all reading, most of us had come from other countries. He said, you're all reading in your newspapers in your home countries about how we're terrified of Iran getting a nuclear weapon because we know that as soon as they get a weapon, of course, they're going to bomb us. He said, it's partly true. It's not all true. It's true that we are very militantly against Iran having a nuclear weapon, but not for the reason that we say. We say that's because we know as soon as they get a weapon, they're going to bomb us. Actually, we don't believe that. We understand that Iran is a practical country, and they know they would be completely wiped off the face of the earth if they ever tried to attack us with a nuclear weapon. They're not going to do that. We don't contradict that argument when it appears in the newspapers because it's an argument that people can understand, even though it's really not true. It sounds like it makes sense, even though inside our security establishment, we know that it doesn't. But we're against Iran getting a nuclear weapon for two other reasons. They're a little more complicated, so we don't go into those in public. The first one is, you never want to use your nuclear weapon. That's a waste. You want to just have it. It intimidates people. People get scared of you. You can push people around when you have a nuclear weapon in ways you can't push them around if you're not nuclear armed. He didn't say, we've learned this ourselves, but I got that subtext. So he said, we don't want Iran to have this added political power. And he said, the other reason is, if Iran becomes has a nuclear weapon capacity, then you're going to see the other countries in the region want to do it. Egypt is going to want it. Turkey is going to want it. Saudi Arabia is going to want it. Then we are really in trouble. So his message was, we're just as much opposed to the Iranian nuclear weapon as you think we are, but not for the reason that you think. I actually have this fantasy, which really seems far-fetched given the rhetoric you're hearing now, that in the long run, Israel and Iran are going to find some kind of rapprochement. Because actually, it goes back to what I said about interests. If they can get over their emotions, and if the nuclear issue is off the table, Iran and Israel are going to find many common interests. They have had a long relationship in the past, not just under the Shah period, but all the way back to ancient history. Cyrus is the only Persian mentioned in the Bible. He's the man that freed the Jews from their Babylonian captivity. You hear a lot of good things about Jews in Iran. There's a natural unhappiness in Iran about all the scenes they see that playing out in the West Bank and in Gaza. But you don't see the visceral sympathy for a Palestinian cause in Iran that you see in some Arab countries. Israel, the Jewish and Persian cultures are very, very old. They're very deep. They're based on education and learning. They have a lot in common. And I could also say that that their view of Arabs, let's say the Persian and Israeli love of Arabs has limits, let's put it that way. Their admiration for Arabs is limited. I'm going to just leave it at that. So they have common feelings, common strategic goals in the region. I think that if they can get past the problems that divide them now, in the long run, Iran has more in common with Israel than it does with many of the other countries in its neighborhood. And I think Israel at some point could come to realize this too. It will take some ideological evolution on both sides, but those are very old cultures and they're used to evolution and they're both very interest oriented. And finally, I completely agree with your final point about human rights. The human rights situation in Iran is awful. But only some kind of a loosening of political pressure holds out the hope for an improvement of the situation there. And if you talk to human rights activists in Iran, you'll find that with 100% certainty, they are urging some kind of progress with the United States. As long as the country is under siege it's difficult for political freedoms to expand. I think if you are concerned about ways to improve the human rights situation in Iran, the best thing you can do is to try to promote a lessening of the tension under which Iranians live.
Thank you very much. Question up here. Yes.
Mr. Kinzer, first of all, thank you for your talk. Second of all, earlier you mentioned that the negotiation with Iran is promising. Gary Samore, in an article that was published by Foreign Policy Research Institute about 2 months ago, mentioned that the main goal of U.S. in the negotiation is to kind of keep the sanctions for the next 20 years and not allow Iran to have any the capability of nuclear energy or nuclear weapon, of course. And we have heard Iranians for many years that they are not going to negotiate over their right to nuclear energy. There is this conflicting story. If you think that this negotiations is promising, if Gary Samore is right, and if that's the case, because he was part of a negotiation in Istanbul, then what's going to happen? I mean, what is U.S. is trying to achieve in these negotiations? Thank you.
The loosening of American sanctions following a possible agreement would have to be a slow and gradual process. It's going to have to be calibrated between Iranian steps and American steps. Part of this is because nothing else would be accepted in Washington. Even if the American negotiators wanted to lift sanctions, they wouldn't be able to do that. That's not a deal we can sell in the United States. In addition, it's a logical way for a negotiation to proceed between countries that have hated each other for so long, that have been at sword's points. You can't base any of this on trust. So I do think the Americans are going to try to lift sanctions very slowly in stages. This will be somewhat frustrating to Iranians, but I think it has to be a tit-for-tat process. If we do reach some kind of an agreement with Iran, it will be a breakthrough in a kind of a general sense, but you're not going to see dramatic changes suddenly. So I do think Americans will keep sanctions on for quite some time. In fact, here's my sense of what's going on inside those negotiations now. A lot of the basic principles have already been agreed upon, but now we're negotiating about numbers. And we're really negotiating about two sets of numbers. Number one is, how many centrifuges is Iran going to be allowed to have? And number two is this: Iran is going to be under a special regimen of inspection and close observation, much more intense than any other country that's a member of the Non-Proliferation Treaty. How long is that going to last? The Iranians are talking about a period of 3 to 5 years. Americans are talking of a period of 20 years. These are the key sticking points in the negotiations now. And let me address your final point, which was about Iranians' right to any kind of a nuclear program. Actually, this was the big thing, I think, that ultimately brought Iranians to the table, is that the Americans effectively changed our offer. It was true that sanctions began to bite. People are unhappy. I'll tell you, the government leaders are not suffering from the sanctions at all. In fact, the Revolutionary Guard, which is the most repressive organ in Iran, is making millions off the sanctions. If you go to a bazaar in Iran, you will find the most modern washing machine, an iPhone 6. And you can buy every appliance just like you can right down in Walmart today. And the reason is sanctions busting. There are speedboats going across the Persian Gulf from Dubai by the dozens every day. And it's the Revolutionary Guard that runs the sanction-busting business. If the sanctions are gone, the Revolutionary Guard is going to lose a lot of money. That would be great, I think, from the perspective of the Iranian public and certainly for the outside world. But that's a reason why there are people in Iran that love the sanctions. But here's the way the offer was changed. Under the Bush administration, the basic bottom line was Iran cannot have nuclear enrichment. No enrichment. So no nuclear power, no medical isotopes, nothing. Obama changed the offer. Obama said, we're going to negotiate over how much enrichment Iran can have. So you could have some, not enough to get you to weapons grade, but we recognize your right to have some enrichment. That really opened up the eyes of the Iranians, and that, coupled with the emergence of a new regime in Tehran, I think, is what brought us to the relatively promising point that we're now at.
Okay. Yes, here in the third row.
List of countries that he was told were next.
Yes. When the Americans were preparing our invasion of Iraq, we heard from the Iranians. Don't forget that the Iranians have hated Saddam Hussein for a long time, a lot longer than we did. We were supporting Saddam Hussein when they were at war with him. So they had every reason to want to help us overthrow Saddam. And essentially, the Iranian message to the United States was this. Look, once you get rid of Saddam, there's going to be trouble. There's going to be upheaval. There's going to be chaos in Iraq. We know Iraq very well, especially the south, where the Shia live. We can help you control this. But that's only going to work if we're with you from the beginning. We'll help you overthrow Saddam. We'll be part of the coalition. And then we can help you stabilize it. But we're not going to, don't call us later. Don't go in by yourself, and then when there's chaos, call us, because then we're not going to be available anymore. And that's what we decided to do. We decided to go in by ourselves. Why would we ally ourselves with Iran, which we then considered to be an enemy? So Iran was excluded from that project. There was a famous line in those days, after we take over Iraq, the next question is, do we want to turn right or do we want to turn left? In other words, is Syria next or is Iran next? And I think this is the reason why we didn't want to cooperate with them. Our idea was, we're not cooperating with you. We're coming after you next. So you're the enemy. There was a famous quote in Time magazine by an unnamed administration official during that period who said, everybody wants to go to Baghdad. Real men want to go to Tehran. So there was a sense in those days that as soon as we brushed aside Saddam and stabilized Iraq in a few weeks, we would then go on and do the same thing in some other country or all the rest of the countries in the Middle East. And I tell you, if things had gone the way we had hoped in Iraq and we were greeted with flowers, as we were told would happen, we might have attacked Iran. So it was the big punch in the face that we got from reality in Iraq, in some ways, might have saved Iran.
Okay. Are there any other questions? Okay, if not, yes, up on the top there.
That lend themselves to both our country and to the country of Iran. And as I talk to Iranian friends, I believe they would agree with you on that. But I'm wondering what the prospects are that the leaders both in Iran and those who are policymakers in Washington are also seeing some of those opportunities and might try to pursue them.
I think it's clear that there's division in both capitals. We have Ayatollahs in Washington and Tehran who are very unhappy with the prospect of reconciliation. In Iran, I think the main force is the one I just mentioned, the Revolutionary Guards, which have their own reasons to oppose reconciliation. But I've noticed, as I've tried to follow the development of politics in Iran as these negotiations are underway, rebellion against the negotiations and condemnation of the negotiations has been slapped down pretty successfully by the Supreme Leader. He has obviously made a decision that, although he doesn't want to give up the anti-Americanism, that's one of the fundamental pillars of the Islamic State. He does think that a nuclear deal is in Iran's interests. And I think he understands the political exigencies inside Iran. They cannot, the election of Rouhani by such a large margin really was to me an example, and I'm sure the leader understood this, of how the people of Iran really want change. So we had an episode, for example, in the Iranian parliament just within the last 10 days in which a member of parliament got up and started denouncing the negotiations. He wants them to stop. He says they're un-Islamic, they're against our country, they're undermining our national interests. We're talking with, basically he said, like Cal Tom, he said we're negotiating with the devil, we shouldn't be doing this. And the speaker tried to quiet him down, he wouldn't quiet down. They turned off his microphone, and then they pulled him out of the parliament chamber. And in Iran, the parliament debates are broadcast live on national television. So everybody saw this. That had to be because it's been, the word has been passed down. I don't want any criticism of these negotiations right now. So on the Iranian side, I feel that if an agreement is signed, you're not gonna see a big rebellion against it. I wish I could say the same in Washington. We don't have a supreme leader. We have a leader, but he doesn't seem very supreme. I can see a big pushback in Washington. I anticipate that, and I'm sure that the negotiators are aware of that and are trying to come up with an agreement that will address some of the fears of critics. Nonetheless, there's no doubt that there's a large group in Washington that's so caught up in the paradigm of conflict that they can't conceive of this concept, a good deal with Iran. Any deal with Iran is a bad deal, they feel. So there is going to be strong resistance. And the agreement is going to have to be shaped in such a way that it will not require congressional action. That's why this agreement with Iran is all, if we reach one, is always going to be called an agreement. It is never going to be called a treaty, because treaties under our Constitution have to be submitted to ratification by Congress. I don't think members of Congress are eager to vote for anything that seems like reconciliation with Iran, but I think many of them don't want to vote against it either. And I think while they might make angry speeches, they'd be just as happy to blame Obama and then let it unfold and see what might happen. I think this agreement is also going to have to include clauses that will not be reversible by another administration. We have to get enough, if there's an agreement, we have to be able to get enough done and make enough progress in the next 2 years so that the agreement cannot later be wiped away. So in short, I wouldn't even give more than a 50-50 chance that we're actually going to reach an agreement. But if we do, I would see, and if you were to tell me an agreement ultimately will be reached, but it will be torpedoed, then I would predict if it's torpedoed, it will be torpedoed in Washington, not in Tehran. And I think, if I can close with this, that leaves us with a great responsibility. It will be a moment when Americans, ordinary people, can make a difference in the world by trying to address our elected leaders, our local representatives in Congress, and try to persuade them to break away from 35 years of hostility and finally give reconciliation with Iran under strict vigilance and control the chance it deserves. Thanks so much for having me.
Thank you very much, Professor Kinzer, for that engaging
and
excellent presentation.
Thank you
very much, and thank you for attending. We look forward to seeing you in the future at other College of International Studies events. Thank you.